Hello and welcome to my presentation about robust solutions of uncertain linear programs. This is my student's bachelor seminar presentation, and the use of TU corporate design doesn't imply any responsibility or approval of TU Darmstadt regarding the content of this presentation. The presentation itself is a summary of a paper of Bentall and Nemirovsky, and you can see the corresponding reference in the description of the video and on the last slide of this presentation with the other references. So let's get started with the presentation. So this is today's agenda. We will start by considering the definition of uncertain linear programs, and then we will talk about in which cases they are computationally tractable. That means that they can be solved efficiently, and this will lead us to uncertain LPs with ellipsoidal uncertainty. And in the last section, we will see that this restriction to ellipsoidal uncertainty actually has instances where we have ellipsoidal uncertainty, namely a single stage simple portfolio problem. And as mentioned, the last section will show the references and the disclaimers I said in the beginning of the video. So let's get started. What are uncertain linear programs? Uncertain linear programs are just like regular linear programs, LPs, but with the little twist that the restriction matrix A isn't known, but comes from some uncertainty set U, and we don't know which instance in this uncertainty set U actually are the real restrictions. And also note that this that we don't lose any generality by assuming the LP to have the following form, because we know that there exists equivalent transformations between different types of LPs, so that this special form with the FTX equal to one isn't any real restriction to the theory developed in this presentation. And also notice that it's no loss of general, it means no loss of generality that we assume that C is certain, because if the objective wasn't certain, we could pass it into the restrictions by introducing an artificial variable. And therefore, this is no loss of generality for each. For each fixed A in U, we denote the corresponding deterministic instance, or also called realization by P index A. And the robust counterpart of P is just a problem where we force the solutions to satisfy all restrictions from U. So it's in some sense more strict, and we call a solution optimal solution or a feasible solution of the robust counterpart, and then put a little R in front of it to show that it's robust feasible and robust optimal. So now we will do two remarks, which are in some sense just another statements which show that without loss of generality, we can restrict ourselves to special cases. So we first see that the robust counterpart doesn't change if we extend U to the closure of the convex hull of it. And to do so, we first consider convexity, and we take two matrices from U and some scalar between 0 and 1, and we see that if some feasible solution if some solution is feasible for A1 and A2, it's also feasible for the convex combination of A1 and A2 because of linearity of linear maps. And we see that we could have had the convex combination of A1 A2 in U anyway, so we can just assume that U is convex in the first place. And for closeness, we first see the continuity of this map, which takes matrix and maps the matrix to its product with a fixed vector x. And we now we do the usual sequence argument by taking a convergent sequence of matrices AN and consider the product between the limit of the AN and x. And now we see that due to continuity of the map, we can pull the x into the limit and see that obviously now the limit exists due to continuity, and every sequence element is non-negative, therefore the limit is also non-negative. And we could have assumed the limit to be in U in the first place, and therefore we can just assume U to be closed from now on. And some natural question arising from the construction of the robust counterpart is how pessimistic is it compared to arbitrary instances from the uncertain LP? And we can formalize this in the sense by asking the following two questions. So if the robust counterpart is infeasible, does it mean that any of the instances is actually infeasible of the uncertain LP? And if we have a robust solution, a robust optimal solution of the robust counterpart, does it actually mean that some instance, deterministic instance is actually so bad? Or might there be a gap in solvability and optimality between the uncertain LP and the corresponding robust counterpart? And the answer to both of the questions is, without any additional exemptions, both no. And we will see this for the first question with the following example, where we have the uncertain LP of minimizing x1 plus x2, and we have some matrices from the uncertainty set U, and they should satisfy this assumption. And we also have the restriction that x1 plus x2 is 1, so we immediately see that the objective is if there is a feasible solution, 1 anyway. And now we see that this uncertain LP is actually feasible. Every instance is feasible. And if A1 1 is greater or equal to 1, then A2 2 is less than 1, and we can choose 1 0 to be a feasible solution, which is then also optimal because, like I said, the objective is 1 anyway if we have a feasible solution. And in the other case, if A1 1 is less than 1, then A2 2 is greater or equal to 1. And we can choose 0 1 as optimal vector, and the optimal value, like I said, is just 1. But if we consider the robust counterpart, then we have to take all the matrices, and it has to satisfy all the matrices, and then we can just see that the two most conservative or most strict restrictions are the ones in those in this matrix. And we immediately see that there's a contradiction, and we see that this is infeasible. So there exists a gap in solvability between those two problems, and the reason for this we can see in the following sketch. So I've sketched the uncertainty set U in green, and this diagonal line segment. But the robust counterpart chooses both parameters to be 1/2, which is actually not the uncertainty set U. So there is no instance of the uncertain LP which is actually so bad as the robust counterpart. The robust counterpart just chooses the smallest rectangle around the uncertainty set and then chooses the worst possible values of the parameters. And in this case, they are 1/2, 1/2, and LP becomes unfeasible. And yeah, this motivates the following definition that so we first need the notion of a projection, which is just this big pi k, which maps a matrix to its kth row. And we say that the uncertainty is constraint-wise if it's just the cross product of each of its components. So that means that it's in some case, in some sense, a rectangle, or a com or a union of rectangles. And we say that the uncertain LP suffices the boundedness assumption if there exists a compact set which contains all feasible solution of every single problem instance. So we take the union over all the feasible solutions over all instances A in U, and this should be in the set Q. And with this definition, we will first do another remark, and then we will have a result which guarantees us affirmative answers to the initial two questions. So first, the second remark. Now we see that the robot's counterpart remains unchanged if we replace the uncertainty set by its direct product. And this kind of comes unsurprising after the initial example, because as we see, the robot's counterpart ignores the dependencies between the restrictions anyway. So we can just assume it to be a rectangle and it to have no dependencies between the restrictions, that one restriction in some component can only occur with other restrictions in other components. And we rule that out by assuming that U is a direct is a cross product of its components. So the one direction is obvious because U is a subset of this direct this cross product, and therefore feasibility of U obviously implies feasibility regarding regarding this cross product. And for the other direction, we assume that X is infeasible for this cross product. So then there are two cases. The first one is a trivial case. If FTX isn't one, then FTX is also not one for U, for PU. So in that case, we also have infeasibility in PU. And the other case is that we have some kth row in one of the matrices in U, such that the scalar product with the vector is strictly negative. And that means that we have some matrix where this row occurs, and which product with the vector x isn't greater or equal to zero, and therefore x is also infeasible for PU since we have found that matrix in U. That finishes the proof. And now we will come to the main result of the first section, which is the following, that the uncertainty set should be constraint-wise and the boundedness assumption should hold. And in that case, we get affirmative answers to the two concerns we had. Namely, PU is infeasible if and only if there exists an infeasible instance PA with A and U, and that PU is feasible with some optimal value, then the optimal value is actually the supremum of all the optimal values of every instance, so there's no gap, and the PU is really in some sense just the worst case of realizations. So now for the proof, we start with the first statement and the direction from PA to PU, and this is again the easy part of the proof because we know that the set of feasible solutions of the robot's counterpart is obviously a subset of every set of feasible solutions of every instance because we just force it to satisfy less restrictions, and therefore this direction can be seen quite easily. For the other direction, we use the remarks from the beginning, and therefore we may assume that U is a cross product of some UI or UK, and UK is the projection of U to the kth component. And now we assume that PU is feasible and construct an infeasible instance in the form that we construct a matrix A bar such that the instance PA bar is infeasible. And to do so, we use the boundedness assumption first. And by infeasibility, we know that the following system has no solution. So ATX should be greater or equal to zero for every A, so for every row from every matrix from the set U. And since we have this cross product identity from U, we can just do the union over all the components of U to get the equivalent statement. And FTX must be one, obviously, and X is in Q by boundedness exemption. So this has no solution. If we negate that, that means that the term below is a open covering of Q. It is a covering because the first system has no solution, and it is open because we only have linear maps, and we take the pre-image under linear maps of open sets, and therefore the sets occurring in the second system are open. So we have an open covering of Q, but now we remember that Q was compact, and therefore there exists a finite subsystem covering Q, and this corresponds to some finite rows AP such that the system has no solution if we only choose those n tilde many rows. And now we just consider the matrices where those rows occur, and those are also finitely many, and we use that to for the following claim: the system has no solution. And obviously it has no solution because in Q, because we just took the rows which have no solution in Q and added more restrictions, namely the other ones that occur in this matrices. And it has no solutions in Q. And due to boundedness exemption, we also know that it has none outside of Q. Because the boundedness assumption just said that there are all the feasible solutions are in Q. So if we have no in Q, we have none. And now we can use Farkas' lemma, and it's a special version of Farkas' lemma. And if you're interested in how to write those matrices next to each other, so that we can use this version of Farkas' lemma, just let me know. I can explain that, but it's kind of boring. It's just Farkas' lemma, and Farkas' lemma says us that we take the contrary problem to 2, and since 2 is infeasible, we have this contrary problem which is solvable. And in this case, that's just the existence of some lambda IP which are not negative, and some mu which is strictly positive, such that the sum over the matrices transposed and multiplied with the vector lambda ip, where I is running from 1 to m, we can also represent this as a double sum. This should be 0, and this is solvable. So there exists actually those lambda ips. And we will denote the ith row of the matrix AP as AIP. And now we do some more definitions, namely that we sum up the lambda I over the p's, and we call it lambda I. And we define some AR bar, which is just the inverse of lambda I multiplied with the lambda IP times the ith row of the p's matrix summed over the p's. and where this is defined. So if lambda I is equal to zero, we just choose it to be AI one. And we immediately see that every A bar I is a convex combination of ith rows from all the matrices. And now we know that U was composed as a cross product of those UIs, and the UIs were convex. So since all the rows are in UI, also the convex combination is in UI. So we know that AI bar is in UI. And due to constraint-wise uncertainty of U, we also know that if we put all of those convex combinated rows into one matrix and call it A bar, then that's also in U. Now, if we write all lambda I into one vector lambda, the equation three implies, so if we just plug all our definitions in this previous equality, then we get this equality. And we see that if we use the same version of Farkas' lemma as we did before, then the solvability of this system is equivalent to the insolvability of the problem instance PA bar, so that A bar x greater or equal to zero, FTX equal to one. So we have proven that we can actually find such an A bar such that PA bar is infeasible. So we come to the second part. This was this part which stated that there's no gap in solvability in optimal solution, in optimal values between the robust counterpart and the uncertain LP. And so by the inclusion one we have done in the beginning, we know that the robust counterpart has more conditions and therefore the optimal value must be worse, which is in a minimization problem bigger or equal to. And now we will see that it's actually not strictly greater than that. And to do so, we defined for convenience S as the supremum of all the optimal values of the instances. And we assume that the robust counterpart is actually strictly worse. And we will lead this to contradiction. So we add to all problem instances of P this inequality. And we immediately see that FTX is one anyway. So this is just equivalent to saying that CTX, so the objective should be less than S, and the new LP, the new uncertain LP P prime, still has constraint wise uncertainty, and it still fulfills the boundless assumption. We have just added another restriction, and all instances are feasible via assumption. And like I've said, this new inequality just means that objective is less than S, which holds by construction, by definition of S anyway. So by one, we can apply the first part we've just proven. We see that robust counterpart PU prime, because of those identities we have, must be also feasible. But PU prime is just PU with this added inequality. And since we assume that the supremum should be strictly less than the optimal value of the robust counterpart, the PU prime should be infeasible. And that's a contradiction we aspired. Now we come to computational tractability. And for the purpose of that, we will rewrite the problem PU by just outsourcing the set of feasible solutions and call it GU. And to investigate computational tractability, so to find conditions under which the robust counterpart can be solved efficiently, we first do some rather technical definitions. The first one is of a separation oracle S of a convex set. That's just an algorithm which verifies for some given vector if this vector is in a set or not. And if it's not the case, then it it returns a separating vector, which is just a vector such that the corresponding plane with this gradient separates the set G from X. Exactly, yeah. So SX TX should be strictly larger than, that's a strict separation between X and G. And so the scalar product between the separator and X should be strictly greater than the scalar product with every point in the set G. And yeah, so, and we need the notion of an inclusion oracle I, and that's for some set U from in the space of matrices, just an algorithm which verifies if AX is non-negative, and if that's not the case, it returns a violating matrix, so just an exception, so a matrix AX in U such that the product is not non-negative. And we need some more definitions. And algorithm will be called efficient if it's if it's fast enough for reword applications. And this is especially the case for polynomial time algorithms, and that's the only case we will need in the following. So this part of definition is intentionally kind of imprecise. We will only need polynomial time, the polynomial time part of this definition. And we say that a problem is computationally tractable if there exists an efficient algorithm that solves it. Now, since GU is a closed convex set, we see that PU. You can see that GU is a closed convex set by similar arguments to the proof of the first remark we did, and this makes PU a problem of minimizing a linear objective over a closed convex set. And we know from reference number two and our lecture Einführung die Optimierung that all we need to solve this efficiently is an efficient separation oracle of GU, so that we can employ a binary search using the ellipsoid method. And now we will see that it actually suffices to have a separation oracle for U to get one for GU, and that's exactly the statement of the following theorem, the tractability principle. It says that an efficient separation oracle SU of U implies an efficient inclusion oracle IGU of GU, which itself implies an efficient separation oracle SGU of GU. And you can also write this maybe a bit more aesthetically pleasing as this diagram. So for the first part of the proof, we want to show that a separation oracle of SGU, a separation oracle SGU of U implies an inclusion oracle IGU of GU. So we have to kind of simulate the work of an inclusion oracle by using just our separation oracle. And we know that the inclusion oracle has to check if AX is non-negative. And we can do that component-wise and rewrite it as a minimization problem, and looking whether or not the minimum of the ith component of AX is actually non-negative for every A in U. So if the optimal values of all this M linear programs are non-negative, then obviously AX is greater or equal to zero for every A in U. And if, say, the kth program is negative, any A from U where this case restriction is violated is obviously a violating matrix. Now, all of the programs have a linear objective, and the set which the LP is defined on is just a projection of U on the ith component. And we know from previous results that that's the convex set. And so all we need to solve this M problems efficiently is the separation oracle of U, efficient separation oracle of U. So we have shown the first implication. Now, to see that an occlusion oracle of GU implies a separation oracle of GU, we again have two cases. The first case is that if FTX isn't one, we can just choose this separating vector as plus or minus F, depending on the sign of FTX minus one. And yeah, so that's the easy case. But now we assume that this case is satisfied, so that FTX is one. And now we call the inclusion oracle to check whether AX is non-negative for every A from the uncertainty set. And now we have two possible outcomes. The first one is that the oracle says yes, then X is in GU. And if it says no, we get a separation as separating matrix, and now we have to construct a separating vector. So this we get a violating matrix. It should be a violating matrix. That's a little typo. So we get a violating matrix AX, such that AX times X isn't non-negative. So in some component K, it is strictly negative. And now we will see that the vector SX, which is just the projection of AX to its kth row with a flipped sign, is a separating vector. And for that, we see that the map V, which maps every Y to the scalar product of Y with the separating vector, this candidate for separating vector, is just the projection of the product with AX to the kth component, then with a flipped sign. So by construction, we have that for X, it's positive because we had negativity before. And on GU, we have that it's less or equal to one, because on GU, if Y is in GU, then AX is greater or equal to zero. That means with flipped sign, it's less than equal to zero. So we indeed have the necessary conditions for it to be a separating vector. So what does this leave us with? We know that in order to solve this robust counterpart efficiently, all we need is U to have a simple analytic structure in the sense that it has an efficient separation oracle. So that's especially the case if U is defined by finitely many efficiently evaluable inequalities. So U is just an intersection of level sets of convex functions. And yeah, to see this, okay, if GI of a matrix is not negative for all I, A is in the uncertainty set, and otherwise we can just choose a gradient, or in the non-smooth case, a subgradient of the violated constraint in the point X as a separator. And one special case of this case where U is given as a intersection of level sets is the one of ellipsoidal uncertainty. In that case, the GI are very easy, namely they are convex quadratic functions, and U is then the intersection of finitely many ellipsoids. And the robust counterpart, that's the most interesting part, in that case becomes a conic quadratic problem. And a conic quadratic problem is just a problem of minimizing a linear objective with the following restrictions. So AI TX plus some constant alpha I is greater or equal to some affine linear map B times some vector plus BI and in the norm. And ellipsoidal uncertainty has some other distinct advantages, namely that we can use ellipsoids to construct polytopes, and ellipsoids are suitable to approximate other convex sets. And as we know, GI are convex quadratic functions, and convex quadratic functions can be easily parameterized with just little data. And also, this quadratic nature of the qualities often occurs in statistical applications. And yeah, we will see this in the last section where we actually see this statistical applications. And so a CQP, as said, is a linear objective, and on a convex set. Oh, sorry, is a linear objective with the following restrictions, and we know that CQPs can be solved efficiently by interior point methods, and this makes this will make robust counterparts of uncertain LPs with ellipsoidal uncertainty computationally tractable. And to see this, we will start the subsequent section about uncertain LPs with ellipsoidal uncertainty. So the goal of this section will be to see that the robust counterpart of uncertain LPs with ellipsoidal uncertainty can be rewritten as a CQP, and CQPs, as mentioned, are computationally tractable, and that makes the robust counterpart also computationally tractable. So to talk about ellipsoids and ellipsoidal uncertainty a bit more precisely, we consider this definition. Some set E in R big K is an ellipsoid if it's the image under a affine linear map phi from RL to RK defined on a set where a matrix applied to this point is in the unit ball. And we say that the uncertainty set is ellipsoidal if it is intersection of finitely many ellipsoids, and if it's bounded and it satisfies the Slater condition. The Slater condition just means that there is some relative interior point of which is in every ellipsoid. So more precisely, there exists a matrix A in U that belongs to a relative interior of each ellipsoid. This just means that for every L, we find some vector UL such that A is the image of phi L on UL, and UL is in the interior of the unit ball. HLUL is in the interior of the unit ball. And now to prepare our claim that the robust counterpart of uncertain linear programs with ellipsoidal uncertainty is a CQP, we first consider the easiest case where U itself is an ellipsoid. And notice that for us, the case where big K is m times n is the interesting case, so that R big K is actually the vector space of matrices. So our goal now will be to derive explicit representations of the robust counterpart as CQP. And yeah, the first case where U is just an ellipsoid, that means that U is just a set of all matrices A, which can be rewritten as the sum of some constant matrix P0 and the linear combination of other matrices PJ, where the linear factors are in the unit ball. And for the proof, we introduce the notation that Rij is the ith row of the jth matrix as a column vector. And we write all the ith rows of all the k matrices into a n by k matrix with those rows as columns, so we write them next to each other. And in that case, we have that phi of u in the ith component is just ri0 plus ri times u. So we just restricted ourselves to the ith component, actually. And now a point x is feasible if it has ftx is 1. And now we use this decomposition into the components by stating that our i0 times x plus riu times x must be non-negative for all the u's in the unit ball and in each component. And we can write this equivalently that r is feasible if we again have ftx is 1 and we do the same trick as before. We write this for all as a minimization problem on the corresponding set, and want it to be non-negative. The minimum, the solution of the minimization problem to be non-negative. So we minimize this term over all u from the unit ball, and as we see, to this u only occurs in front of ri tx, and to minimize that, we can see by Cauchy-Schwarz inequality that this actually gets minimal if it's obviously negative. So it and if it's just the negative of the other vector, so it's just the opposite. So u is minus ri tx, and for it to be in the unit ball, we then have to divide by the norm of ri tx, and that leads us with the vector product, a scalar product ri tx with itself in the numerator, and the norm in the denominator. And we know that the numerator is just the norm squared, and that cancels with the denominator, that and leaves us just with the norm of ri tx. So yeah, we see that we can replace this by the norm of ri tx, and so we just have seen that pu is this CQP where we minimize the linear objective and we have ftx is 1, and yeah, and the other conditions in each component we just derived. And a slightly more difficult case where u is as a cross product of constraint-wise ellipsoids. And in that case, we actually do more or less the same proof as right now, but on the different factors. And we see that we get a completely analogous result. And we again have the robust counterpart is a conic quadratic problem. And now for the general case where RC is just some the robust counterpart is just some general just has some general ellipsoidal uncertainty. The proof is rather technical and it's quite lengthy and it surpasses the scope of this presentation and handout. Furthermore, it uses Fenchel duality theory, and we didn't cover that in Einführung die Optimierung, and therefore I omitted the proof. If you're interested in reading it, you can read it in the appendix of the first reference. So, what is the corollary of this theorem? It leaves us with we know CQPs can be solved in polynomial time, as mentioned by interior point methods. So therefore, robust counterparts of uncertain linear programs with ellipsoidal uncertainty are computationally tractable. And that's the main result of this presentation. And to see that ellipsoidal uncertainty actually occurs in applications and occurs in applications. It isn't kind of constructed and far off reality, we consider the following section, which is about a simple portfolio problem. So what's the problem? We want to invest €1 into a portfolio of a market where N shares are available to us. And we have to invest a positive amount of money, a non-negative amount of money into each share. And the share after this one period has some uncertain value, namely PI, which is also non-negative. And after this period, the portfolio gets sold, and our objective is quite naturally to maximize the value of the portfolio at the end of the period for us to make the maximum yield. Now, if we rewrite all the values, so all the prices into one price vector and all our investments into one investment vector X, we can rewrite this as a maximization problem of the product of P and X, where the sum norm of X must be 1 and all the X non-negative. Now, what if we just restrict ourselves first if to the case where P is known? Okay, then the situation is quite clear. We invest all our money into the one share which will have the highest value, and let's call it I star, and then that means that X I star is 1 and all the other X I are 0. Slightly more interesting, if we assume that the PI are uniformly distributed on some symmetric interval around the expected value PI star with some deviation sigma I, that means that the price vector comes from a n-dimensional rectangle with side lengths 2 sigma I in the ith dimension. And then we will consider two different approaches. The first approach is quite simple. It's a greedy approach. We want to maximize the expected yield. We want to maximize the product of P and X. And the product of P and X is just a sum, and we know the expected value interchanges with sums. So that's just XT with the expected value of this vector P, which is just P star. So we just get exactly the same linear program as in the case where P is known, just that we replace P with P star. But this approach completely ignores any deviations and is therefore quite risky. And that's why we now consider the robust counterpart approach, where we restrict ourselves to an uncertainty set U of all the price vectors which seem plausible to us. And now we choose those strategy which maximizes our yield in the worst case on this uncertainty set. Yeah, and we do this by the trick I've mentioned in the beginning of the presentation, namely that we introduce the artificial variable y and force y to be less than or equal to p times x. Now, how to choose u? If we are very conservative, we choose u to be just all possible values the price vector can attain. So u is u rectangle. I've made a small rectangle. And in that case, the R optimal policy would be just, okay, what is the worst case? The worst case is that every share attains its lowest value. And since we want to maximize this, we obviously choose the policy which fully invests into the share with the best worst case, so with the highest minimum return PI star minus sigma I. But this is now way too conservative to be of any interest or any application. So we have to choose U differently. And for that, we introduce a parameter theta between 0 and square root of n, which quantifies our affinity towards risk. and we define a different uncertainty set u theta by all the price vectors which have a normalized distance to its expected value squared less than and summed over all shares less than a theta squared. So if we choose theta to be larger, we have a bigger uncertainty set. We are more conservative, less likely to take risks. And if we take theta to be small, we have a small uncertainty set, so we are quite confident and we take a lot of risk. So if we choose theta to be zero, we are at a greedy approach again. And if we choose theta to be square root of n, we are at this U rectangle, very conservative approach again. So from the theory we developed so far, we know that the robust counterpart of a PU theta euro is computationally tractable because it's a quantic-quadratic problem. And therefore we can make many simulations in a short period of time. Namely, we made the paper one made the following numerical example. With 150 shares, a risk affinity of 1.5 and 3,600 simulations, where the prices are increasing in I from 1.15 linear to 1.20, and also deviations increase in some square root manner, so that the more promising investments are also those which inherit more risk. And now we compare the degree policy with the robust counterpart approach we constructed on the last slide. So the greedy approach just chooses the share with the highest expected value. So that's the 150th share. And so we have an expected yield of 1.2 euros, but we have a very large standard deviation of sigma 150, which is 0.2896, so almost 0.3. The robust counterpart, on the other hand, has an R optimal value, and R optimal value is the optimal value of this optimization problem of 1.15, and actually the simulations all raise resulted in a yield between 1.11 euros and 1.23 euros, so we never lost money. And we had an average yield of 1.18. So we see that the yield is not much less, it's 2 cents, or the profit is 10% less to the greedy approach. But the standard deviation is 0.017. So we have that robust counterpart offers about 15 times more stability in terms of standard deviation at a cost of about 10% profit. So it just has a much better performance in the simulations where we, in the simulations, we chose the price vector at the end of the period each time independently and uniformly distributed on this n-dimensional rectangle. And now, three characteristics of the optimal solution of the robust counterpart are particularly important. It's expected profit. The expected price vector times the strategy we chose minus one, its standard deviation, and its net R optimal value, so the R optimal value of the optimization problem minus one. And the following graph shows that shows the dependency of those three quantities depending on the theta, and we see that from theta greater or equal to one onwards, they don't change too much. They're rather insensitive towards changes in theta. So that suggests that our choice of theta being equal to 1.5 wasn't necessary for a result that the robot's counterpart is much more has much better performance than the greedy approach. So the robust counterpart approach appears to be an appropriate policy for different levels of risk affinity. Now to the references and disclaimers. So like I've said in the beginning, the entire presentation is a summary of paper one of Bental and Nemirovsky. And the second paper is only referred to once. This was directly after definition 2.1, where I said that linear objective over a convex set can be solved efficiently with the ellipsoid method. So, and like I've said, this is student seminar presentation, so don't choose this as a trustworthy source. If you think that something might be wrong, just look at it with a grain of salt. And the use of TU corporate design doesn't imply any responsibility or approval of TU Darmstadt regarding the content of this presentation and video. So yes, thank you for your attention. I'm happy if you have some critic or questions which you leave in the comment section. Yeah, thank you.